Tradition. The Reformation was first introduced by Martin Luther on October 31st, 1517, and later explored by John Calvin, a French theologian who is credited with the development of Reformed theology. John Knox, a Scotsman and a Roman Catholic priest who studied with Calvin in Geneva, Switzerland, brought back Reformed teachings to Scotland, where the Presbyterian Church was founded. The Reformation questioned the centrality of the priest to our relationship with God and allowed all believers to access the salvation found in the words of Scripture. Having more printed Bibles available and a growing literate society allowed for this transformation. Reformed theology is often divided into five tenets: sola scriptura, by Scripture alone, sola fide, by faith alone, sola gratia, by grace alone, solus Christus, Christ alone, soli Deo gloria, glory to God alone. We invite you to hold these tenets in mind while we sing the hymns requested by our members. We also thank once again Peggy Dillman for her research into finding out more about the background of each of these hymns to give us a great understanding of them before we present them today. So let us turn our hearts and minds to worship. True growth in faith is only accomplished as we continue to encounter the Word of God as interpreted by the Holy Spirit through study and message, and ask for the help of God to go out and live as the Word ordains. Join now in the call to worship from Psalm 150. Praise the Lord.
Praise God in his sanctuary.
Praise him in his mighty firmament.
Praise him for his mighty deeds.
Praise him according to his surpassing greatness.
Praise the Lord.
Let us consider what we believe. I believe it was for his purpose and pleasure that God created all that exists. God created from nothing, and all was good, and was created to display his glory. And then God shared with mankind so that we could live the gift of grace and assign stewards of all creation. All power and glory are his. Yet God continues to interact with mankind through the life of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. God continues to inspire actions of goodness, and so goodness can still be seen. Praise ye the Lord, the Almighty, is a hymn based on Joachim Neander's German hymn, Lobe den Herren, den machtigen König der Erde, published in 1680. The melody used by Neander, first published in 1665, exists in many versions and is probably based on a folk tune. The text paraphrases Psalm 103 and Psalm 150. Catherine Winkworth published her English translation of the hymn in 1863. This translation appears in our hymnal.
God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, he will not fear though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though the waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose stream makes glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her, she will not fail. God will help her at the break of day. Nations are in an uproar, kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice, the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us, and the God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see the works of the Lord, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Let us consider what we believe. God is an active and engaged power that continues to be involved in creation throughout time, and his constant presence testifies to the promise of God's providence for his creation. God calls his creation to remain in communion with him through the power of the Holy Spirit, and remains responsive to the prayers of mankind, which flame the fire of hope and community. Through the life and love of his Son, Jesus Christ, the gap is bridged, and we are able to know more of God and see more of who we are meant to be. This hymn is identified with the Protestant Reformation led by Martin Luther. Luther posted his 95 theses on the door of the church at Wittenberg. Luther broke with Rome in 1521, refusing to retract his writings before the Diet or Assembly of Worms. He is recognized as the leader of the German Reformation. Luther's German version is a metrical paraphrase of Psalm 46. More than 100 English translations of the hymn exist. A Unitarian minister from the United States, Frederick Henry Hedge, wrote the translation that appears in our hymnal. Our dear friend Bill Kutz requested this hymn when we first asked for suggestions. When asked why, Bill replied, "It shows God's supreme power and protection for his people. I also see a reflection of God's majesty." Thank you, Bill, for all you provided to the people through your lessons and life.
Thank you.
Let us put aside the arrogance of our religion and have confidence in God. Join me in the prayer of confession. O Lord, we count on your mercy, yet expect you to punish the wicked. We serve you in faith, but when others don't, we forget the joy of doing your work. We pout in our prosperity when you distribute your generosity so unjustly. Forgive us, Lord, for the sins we know in our hearts. Save us, Lord, from the sins we hide. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Jesus Christ, the only Son of our Heavenly Father, comes so that we might know God's mercy. He suffered and died, paying the wages of our sin. Our sins are forgiven. We have been graciously granted the privilege of believing in Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. May we live our lives in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Philippians chapter 1, verses 20 to 21. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage, so that now as always Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain.
Let us again consider what we believe. We are called to salvation by the Holy Spirit and receive as a free gift of grace the eternal love of God. This grace is given to us freely. It is ours to accept or reject. Only through the power of the Holy Spirit can our damaged souls open the truth and love of God's righteousness. Fanny Crosby was visiting her friend Phoebe Knapp as the Knapp home was having a large pipe organ installed. The organ was incomplete, so Mrs. Knapp, using the piano, played a new melody she had just composed. When Knapp asked Crosby, "What do you think the tune would say?" Crosby replied, "Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine." The hymn first appeared in 1873 in an issue of Palmer's Guide to Holiness and Revival Miscellany. It appeared with complete text and piano score. Crosby had lost her sight in midlife, and the popular song reflects her walk of faith as expressed by the Apostle Paul in Philippians 1:21. For to me to live in Christ and to die is gain.
Oh, Romans 5, verses 1 through 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in our hope of sharing the glory of God. More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, which has been given to us.
Let us once again consider what it is that we believe. God so willed that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for our sins, bringing salvation and restoration to the undeserving. This fact confirms that our salvation is a gift of a gracious and loving God. Mankind is unable to make the commitment to restoration or salvation because of the flawed nature of our being, lacking perfect love and obsessed with personal gain. Only the divine nature of God could accomplish this. Amazing Grace was written in 1772 by John Newton. Newton had an unfortunate and troubled childhood, losing his mother when he was just 6 years old, and he spent years fighting against authority, even going as far as to desert the Royal Navy in his 20s. Later, abandoned by his crew in West Africa, he was forced to be a servant to a slave trader, but was later rescued. On the return trip to England, a violent storm hit and almost sank the ship. But upon his return to England, he became a slave ship master, bringing slaves from Africa to England, making multiple trips, and often treating slaves badly. In 1754, he became violently ill on a sea voyage and abandoned his life as a slave trader, the slave trade and seafaring altogether, wholeheartedly devoting his life to God's service. He was ordained as an Anglican priest in 1764 and was popular as a preacher and hymn writer and penned some 280 hymns. Amazing Grace first appeared in the Olney Hymns, printed by Newton and poet-slash-fellow writer William Cowper. It was later set to the popular tune New Britain in 1835 by William Walker. In later years, Newton fought to abolish the African slave trade.
Yeah. Lamentations 3, 19 through 25. Remember my affliction and my bitterness, the wormwood and the gall. My soul continually thinks of it and is bowed down within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul, and therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him.
Let us consider what we believe. We believe in the truth of God's unchanging love, reinforced by the life of Jesus Christ as the Word made flesh, and interpreted and transferred by the endless movement of the Holy Spirit. God calls us to faith as his elect, and by this links our faith to the eternal truth of his love and mercy, as presented through the Scriptures. God's love and mercy have no beginning or end, just as God has no beginning or end. Regardless of the trial, God will be there waiting to love and support his beloved. Thomas Chisholm was born in a simple log cabin in Franklin, Kentucky in 1866. Lacking a high school education or any college, he became a school teacher and later went into the newspaper business. The following years found him ordained a pastor, but poor health forced him to leave the ministry. After a time of recuperation, he moved to New Jersey to become an insurance agent. He was a prolific writer of poetry, and he sent a collection of poems to his good friend William Runyon, a musician associated with Chicago's Moody Bible Institute, who also worked for a hymnal publishing company. While leafing through the collection, Runyon was particularly taken by the poem, "Great is Thy Faithfulness." Out of a simple prayer, Runyon's melody took shape, and the completed hymn was published by Runyon the same year. The hymn was slow to catch on in churches until Billy Graham began to include it in his crusades. It was introduced to the people of Great Britain during Graham's crusade there in 1954, and it has since become one of England's most popular hymns.
Romans 1, verses 16 through 20. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since that may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's investible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse.
Let us consider what we believe. Christ came to model obedience to God and embody absolute love and truth. By living and teaching among the people, Christ showed God's glory in a world of darkness, freed the helpless to seek justice and mercy, and ransomed the forgotten to be reconciled to God in the everlasting kingdom. The inspiration for the poem came when Boberg and some friends were walking home from church near Kronoberg, Sweden. Presently, a thundercloud appeared on the horizon, and soon lightning flashed across the sky. Strong winds swept over the meadows and billowing fields of grain. The thunder pealed in loud claps. Then rain came in cool, fresh showers. In a little while, the storm was over and a rainbow appeared. When Boberg arrived home, he opened the window and saw the Bay of Monsteros like the mirror before him. From the woods on the other side of the bay, he heard the song of the thrush. The church bells were tolling in the quiet evening. It was this series of sights, sounds, and experiences that inspired the writing of this song. The poem became matched to an old Swedish folk tune and sung in public for the first known occasion in a church in the Swedish province of Värmland in 1888. Eight verses appeared with the music in 1890.
Oh,
pause now for the prayers of the people. Dear Lord, we thank you for those who have used your Spirit to reform the church. We thank you that you are still at work in the life of the church, reforming us, reshaping us, and remaking us into your image. One of the ways we reflect your image, Lord, is how we care for one another with love, care, and prayer. So we pray for those who are in the hospitals today. We pray for those at home with illnesses. We pray for those in nursing homes and those who are homebound. We pray for their families during these times. We pray for those who are facing death and for those grieving death. We pray for doctors, nurses, healthcare workers, and caretakers. Lord, may we reflect your image to the world. May we reflect your image in how we love, care, and pray for the world. Lord, may we put into action our love, care, and prayers for the world, engaging in the lives of our siblings and standing firm for justice, mercy, and equality. Lord, we pray for your church, that we be a beacon of hope, grace, love, and light in this world. May our arms and hands, reaching out to those in need, reflect your love for all. May our forgiveness of one another reflect the forgiveness we find in the death and resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
In John chapter 12, verses 44 to 47. Then Jesus cried aloud, Whoever believes in me, believes not in me, but in him who sent me. And whoever sees me, sees him who sent me. I have come as light into the world, so that everyone who believes in me should not remain in darkness. I do not judge anyone who hears my words and does not keep them, for I came in not to judge the world, but to save the world.
Let us now consider again what it is that we believe. We believe we grow in the faith by the call of the Holy Spirit to a life of unrealized potential. The good that we can do is made possible through the grace offered by Jesus. We believe that sin will never cease to live in us, but through the grace offered by the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and with the help of the Holy Spirit, sin's dominion over us can be limited. Be Thou My Vision is a Celtic hymn. The text is attributed to St. Fallon, a 16th century Celtic monk and follower of St. Columba, whose feast day is January 29th. The tune, called Slain, is a traditional Irish ballad melody. The text and the tune were combined in the Irish church hymnal in 1919. St. Fallon went blind in the middle of his life, and the opening verse of the hymn draws poignantly upon his experiences. The second verse expands upon the discussion of God's identity and his presence. The third verse introduces the idea of God as an inheritance and a treasure. On a personal note, this was a great favorite hymn of my mother's, and so it is with great pride that my brother and I will present this morning.
Call out my day, O God.
We believe that all of God is goodness, and God was before all things and will remain after all things. God's provision cannot be confused with comfort in this world, for it transcends our temporal needs and refers to the fulfillment of God's ultimate purpose to restore creation to absolute goodness and love. Here I Am, Lord is a Christian hymn written by the American composer of Catholic liturgical music, Dan Shute, in 1981. Its words are based on Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, and 1 Samuel chapter 3. Shute's hymn is also sung in many Protestant worship services and is found in many hymnals and missalettes. This hymn, although not directly part of the Reformation, serves as a wonderful benediction for today's process, and so ask you to remember this as we leave today. As God has loved us, we are called to love and serve creation. This call is felt in different ways by different people. The challenge is to answer the call, to engage in God's world as a reflection of God's goodness and love, and to continue to grow closer to our Savior by the power of the Holy Spirit.